Hey, Daniel.
Hey, Mikhail.
Hey, did you know that each and every week there's a weekly worship companion document that you can download to follow along with the worship service at home?
Wait, are you telling me that every week there's a weekly worship companion that I can follow the service along just by downloading?
That's almost exactly what I said. Yes, the weekly worship companion is a PDF document you can download, the link to which is in the video description below, and it has all of the lyrics, all of the scriptures, and all of the prayers for the services that we produce.
So if I want to follow along and read the lyrics of the worship service, I would download the weekly worship companion.
That would be in the weekly worship companion, yes.
Okay, and if I would want to read along the scriptures that, say, Pastor Robbie is reading from, I would download the weekly worship companion.
That would be in the weekly worship companion too, yes.
All right, and also if I was wanting to follow along with the prayers, I would download the weekly worship companion.
Week to week, the content of the service is in the weekly worship companion, and you can download it using the link in the video description below.
Wow, what a wonderful world we live in where we can download a new weekly worship companion each and every week.
What a wonderful world indeed, where weekly worship companions can help us connect to the services that we watch while we wait to gather. Wonderful.
Weekly
worship
companion.
We're so glad you joined us this morning. If you're joining us for the first time, welcome. We're going to take communion together at the table, everybody. So go ahead and grab your elements of communion. And today we're celebrating. So come on, let's dance like the weight has been lifted. We celebrate the Lord this morning. So we're going to worship together. Sing, let's sing. Come out of the shadows. Come out of the break into the wild and don't be afraid. Well, let's go. Run into wide open spaces, graces waiting for you. And dance like the weight has been lifted, graces waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. The Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Come on, let there be freedom.
The Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Our lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. They're breaking, they're breaking. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Come on, put your hands together in your living room. Come on, let's clap. We dance this morning in the freedom that we know. Come on, let's sing it again with the Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Yeah, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. Let's sing this. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Come on, today we're talking about dancing in this freedom that we know. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Yes, it has. That's what we believe this morning. Come on, we sing. Dance like the weight has been lifted. 'Cause He did it. He's already done. Like it's lifted. Like the weight has been lifted, the work is already done. Yeah, oh, dance like the weight has been lifted. Oh, where the Spirit sings, oh, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. You sing it, let there be freedom. Yeah, let there be freedom. Let there be freedom.
Good morning, Oasis.
Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and His compassion is over all that He has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is faithful in all His words and gracious in all His deeds. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. Let us pray.
God of compassion,
we give you thanks for the salvation you have revealed to us through Christ. Jesus, our wisdom and strength, teach us to take up His gentle yoke and find rest from our burdens and cares. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame, and who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive, and all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. Your mercy has saved my soul, and now your freedom is all that I know. The old me knew Jesus when I met you, and you called me. Break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name,
going to share grace and peace with one another, so let's get ready to do that now in a moment.
Good morning, Oasis. It's now my favorite time of the service. It's time for our grace and peace. So grab your phone or your computer and text or phone or email a friend and just tell them you're thinking about them. And I have an extra challenge this week. We've been in this pandemic for about 4 months now, and so my challenge is to go old school and write a letter to someone this week. I'm sure it would be a real encouragement to them. And until we can be together, grace and peace.
Grace and peace.
We love you, Oasis.
Bye.
Good
Grace and peace, Oasis.
Great job, everybody.
Holy God, we enter this time of prayer mindful of our inability to be content. We are restless and dissatisfied, both in times of need and in times of plenty. Instead of giving thanks for that which we have, we lament that which we feel we lack. We burden ourselves with things that do not offer that which they promise. We burden others with expectations they cannot possibly meet. We burden creation with our relentless abuse of the earth and its creatures. As we pause to acknowledge our total dependence on you, reveal to us the abundance you pour out upon your people.
We rejoice in the myriad of colors that show your glory around every corner, the green leaves on the trees, the oranges and purples and pinks of blooming flowers, the flash of the red cardinal, and the shiny black of the crow. Help us to stop and notice the beauty you so lavishly create and share.
Hear your people, hear our prayer. Hear your people, hear our prayer.
We celebrate the goodness you embed in humanity. We look for the helpers, the healers, the teachers, mentors, leaders, and encouragers who spend their lives looking to the interest of others, seeking to serve rather than to be served.
We give thanks for those closest to us, the people who love us at our worst, cheer us when we are at our lowest, care for us when we are at our weakest, and want for us what is best. They show us what it means to be called beloved and significant.
We praise you for the gift of this day, whatever it entails, knowing that you are present with us, that Christ prays for us, that the Spirit intercedes for us. We rest in these promises so that, emboldened by your power, we can share these truths with those yet to know of their priceless worth in your eyes.
We lament the suffering so pervasive in our world. We cry out to you with sighs too deep for words, for those who go to bed hungry, the people fearing for their lives, the vulnerable too long exploited, and your children denied justice. We lift up to you the sick and the brokenhearted, the lonely and the impoverished. As we are yoked to Christ, yoke us to those who need their burdens lightened and their souls refreshed.
Hear your people, hear our prayer. Oh, hear your people, hear our prayer.
We pray for the Oasis community and the city of Lakeland. Help us to work together to be the hands and feet of Jesus in a hurting city. Help us to work together to care for one another and the vulnerable in our community.
We pray for Hope and the Wingo family. Grant them safety and healing of any and all infections.
We pray for Hannah Laudell, who is suffering from the coronavirus. Give her swift relief.
We pray for Delma Gibson. Strengthen her heart and give the doctors clarity and wisdom for a clear course of treatment.
We make our prayers in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to say when we pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Point in our service where we take up the offering. I want to say thank you. Thank you for your generosity and thank you for your faithfulness. A community church like Oasis couldn't possibly do what it is that we do without your support. And during these times that seem pretty uncertain, leaning into that faithfulness and practicing that generosity, I think is really very important. It is a show of faith, and I'm grateful that you're continuing to do so, and I encourage you to do that. And if for some reason you haven't been, then let me suggest to you that you give it a try. I believe it's the right thing to do, and I believe that the Lord will bless you. There are, of course, four ways in which you can give. You can give by mailing a check to the church. You can give online at our website. You can give by texting the amount to 84321, or you can give by the Church Center app. Listen to this confession that we like to say about giving. Godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world, and we take nothing out of it. We who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. We are determined to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on God and on the uncertainty of wealth. We desire to be rich in good deeds and willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. Amen.
Thank you.
Love cannot remain by itself. It has no meaning. Love has to be put into action, and that action is service. Whatever form we are, able or disabled, rich or poor, it is not how much we do, but how much love we put in the doing. A lifelong sharing of love with others.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be back with you. Our gospel passage this morning that our lesson is coming from is really in two parts. The first part is a bit of a parable. It's really an analogy. Jesus asks this rhetorical question, what example can I give that would describe this generation? And he does so. And it's interesting. He talks about, you know, children kind of playing a flute and people not wanting to dance, or someone playing a dirge, like a funeral song, and people not wanting to mourn. And as he kind of explains that parable, he comes to kind of what's the second part of our passage, where he opens up in a prayer to the Father. And he talks about the way in which wisdom kind of doesn't work a bit. And he offers this most heartfelt and beautiful invitation of discipleship. So let's listen to that first part of the passage.
Matthew 11:16-19. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds.
I saw this t-shirt for sale once, and the t-shirt said, I'm the one your mother warned you about. Pretty risque, I guess. Not exactly sure who would choose to wear such a thing. But, you know, it's playful. It suggests, I guess, that I'm risky. I'm playful. You know, I drive my car too fast and listen to my music too loud. And perhaps I say some unsavory words now and then. It's interesting to think about that. All cultures really have this general idea that our parents, our moms and dads kind of warn us that there are certain folk that we should stay away from. The ancient Israelite culture wasn't any different. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 21, it's kind of telling young people, hey, listen, stay away from false prophets. And then in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 18 to 21, it says some very specific things about a rebellious son. There it says that parents who have a son who's being rebellious need to come out in public, and they should say this. They should announce to the community, this son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey us. He is a glutton and a drunkard. And then what the community is supposed to do is then stone the son, like execute him, put him to death. That's pretty harsh terms. So if there's anyone from the youth group that's listening, be sure to obey your mom and dad, or if you have your children with you, that seems to be maybe some PG-13 at least. The idea that a rebellious child would be stoned to death. But that language, that this rebellious son in Deuteronomy is described as a glutton and a drunkard, someone who just gorges themselves and eats too much, and someone who's all the time getting drunk and kind of drinking too much. It is, of course, what we're familiar with in this passage, that some people are calling Jesus this very thing. The parable, though, about playing the flute and not dancing and kind of playing the dirge and not mourning. The dirge and not mourning, I believe, to be a reference to John the Baptist. He was an ascetic. And he had come into the community with this very kind of stringent way of living, very strict way. And it was too much for the average person. Like, who can do that? In fact, he was living such a strict religious life that some people suggested that the only way he could do it was if he was possessed by a demon. Like, that was too much for them. They were kind of unwilling to believe that this was a requirement for folks. Like, this can't be the way. John the Baptist was too much. But then Jesus comes, and he's kind of constantly celebrating. He would be represented in the analogy of the one who plays the flute, but they're not willing to dance. Jesus comes, and he's kind of constantly celebrating the coming of the kingdom. And he's inviting everyone to the table. And he's inviting folks to the table that, according to Jewish tradition, according to Jewish law, that they shouldn't come. He's having dinner, of course, with the Pharisees. That might be expected of a rabbi. But then he's also having dinner with the tax collectors, with sinners, with the unsavory type, with the very ones that our mothers have warned us about. And so people are thinking, this rabbi, he's too much. I expect that I might hear, you know, some folks say, have you heard about that rabbi from Nazareth? He lives in Capernaum. Like, I heard that his disciples were making bread on the Sabbath. And then someone speaks up, but I heard that he healed a man with a withered hand. And they said, yeah, on the Sabbath. Like, he's just finding ways to break the law. Very and very unsavory. Not the person that we should follow. They're treating Jesus as though he's the one that our mothers warned us about. I mean, he's the rebellious son. And by saying that Jesus is a drunkard and a glutton, in that context, that suggests that not only is Jesus unworthy to be followed, but that actually he deserves to be put to death, that he's a danger to the society. Jesus then focuses on three little villages, fishing villages around the Sea of Galilee. This part wasn't in the section that we read, but it sits in between the two sections. And Jesus mentions Capernaum and Bethesda and Chorazin. Capernaum, of course, is where he lived. And these other places, a very short walk from where he lived, would have been recipients of Jesus' ministry. Like, they would have seen Jesus heal the sick and exorcise demons. They perhaps would have been, folks from those villages would have been part of the multitude that were fed when the story of the fishes and the loaves. Yet they so wanted a different type of Messiah. They were kind of so committed to their own religious fundamentalism that was either economically driven or kind of culturally driven in a way that was kind of exclusive and not inclusive, that Jesus just kind of opens up into a prayer. And in that prayer, he describes the Father in some really beautiful, really personal ways. So let's take just a minute and listen to the second half of our gospel passage today. It opens with Jesus' prayer.
Matthew 11:25-30. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
I love the way that Jesus talks about the Father. The other day I was watching this documentary. It was about Garth Brooks. I'm a big Garth Brooks fan. Surely you've heard of him. He's like the most successful recording artist in history. And in this documentary, amongst the people that were interviewed were his three daughters. And after a decade or so of just extreme success, Garth had these three young daughters at the time. And one of them used a word, and she kind of pronounced it in a way that he felt was not the way their family would typically pronounce that word. And he realized it's how their nanny pronounced it. And it really convicted him. And he thought, I'm shirking my responsibility. Like the most important thing I have to do on this planet is to raise and care for my three girls. And I'm not doing it. And so at the height of his career, while he was the most kind of popular artist, not just in country music, but he had crossed over and became wildly popular in lots of different arenas, he retired at a young age. He moved back to Oklahoma and raised his children. Now, the story is complicated in a lot of ways. He had been divorced, but it was 14 years later when his youngest daughter went away to college that he kind of came out of retirement and has continued to have a kind of a second career in music. But the ways in which his children spoke of him, things that no one else would know unless you were a daughter of Garth Brooks, personal things, loving, endearing things, they all at various times would tear up as they reflected on their father. And I think in some ways that's exactly what we see Jesus doing here as he talks about the Father. Tom Wright, in his commentary on Matthew's, describes it, he says, with this analogy, he says, imagine you're a musician and you live in a culture where all the music that's being performed and played professionally is out of tune and out of rhythm. Like, there's no one who's actually playing the songs or singing the songs the way they're supposed to be done. But you are. And all you want to do is to be able to share with everyone else, like, hey, that's not the way that's supposed to go. Like, listen to me. Like, let me teach you how this is supposed to be. And as he starts to do so, people are like, no, especially like the leadership, like that's not how we do it. And that's not the tradition as we know it. But then there are other people, just regular folk, that are like, man, I've never heard anything like this before. Like, this is the most beautiful thing I've ever heard in my life. Like, have you heard this? There was a movie came out, I guess last year or the year before. It was called Yesterday. And in it, there's like this electrical event and all the electricity goes out around the planet. And when it comes back on, things have changed. There are parts of history that are missing. And there's this one musician, and he was a singer-songwriter and had tried to kind of make a living, but he wasn't doing very well. But he was the only one who remembered the Beatles. Like, the Beatles, it was as though the Beatles had never existed. And so he began to play some of their songs, and people went crazy about them. And so he becomes this kind of wildly successful because he's reproducing the Beatles songs. If you haven't seen it, I would encourage you to watch it. I think it's very heartwarming, and I don't want to, you know, spoil it for you. But that's the idea. So Jesus, as we say, tells us things that about the Father that only a son could know. And it challenges again the status quo. So Jesus goes kind of to the very heart. Like, in the Jewish tradition, there was this strong sense in which wisdom was considered kind of the great teacher. But it had developed in such a way that knowing that language, because the Hebrew language had kind of fallen out of use during the exile and shortly thereafter, and Aramaic had become the dominant spoken language, especially in Galilee. So kind of the studying of scriptures had become an elite event. And in the ancient world, the literacy rate was very, very low. Like even rabbis, most rabbis probably couldn't read or write. They learned by memory, right? That they would hear it over and over. And so it was an oral tradition. And you can pick up on a hint of this as the scriptures talk about like the scribes of the Pharisees or the scribes of the Sadducees. So perhaps not even every Pharisee could read or write, but the scribes could. The scribes were the ones who wrote for the group, and the others kind of learned orally. So in that culture, that your average person would have thought that kind of the wisdom and the knowledge and the intimacy that was supposed to come with it was reserved for the very few. It would have been as unavailable to your average fisherman or farmer or carpenter as rocket science or, you know, being a test pilot for the Air Force or something. It was a really, really kind of elite thing. But Jesus says, it's not the wisdom, it's not for the wise, that this is actually available for infants. Like, this is something only the children know. Like with Garth Brooks, this isn't something a fan would know. This isn't something a music historian would know. This is something only a daughter would know. Or in the case of a boy, only a son would know. And so Jesus says, he refers to his own yoke. So it wasn't uncommon for the Pharisees to talk about the yoke of the Torah, like this kind of burden that would be laid upon those who knew. I mean, I can appreciate that in some ways. Paul will say that to those who know, you know, there's the responsibility to those who have much, you know, to those who know things, there's a responsibility for you to kind of carry that knowledge. And so that was the idea. The burden of the Torah was they knew the law, so therefore they needed to follow the law. They knew the law, so therefore they needed to teach the law to others who couldn't read or to others who didn't know, who hadn't studied. And so there was this sense that taking on the yoke of the Torah was this kind of great responsibility. But Jesus seems to offer something other. He says, take my yoke upon me, on you and learn from me. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. That Jesus has a yoke. And he has something to teach us, but it's not something that's reducible to what a text and the studying of a text can do. It's personal. Know Jesus. And knowing Jesus, you can know the Father. Like that opens this thing up to everyone. Jesus, there's this passage there that says that Jesus says that he is meek and lowly, and that you can come to him and he will give you rest. That meek and lowly is not just saying that Jesus has reached some kind of spiritual maturity and authority, but it is the manner in which he behaves. He's not policing us. He's not going to stand over us like a really mean school teacher and kind of crack our knuckles with a ruler. He's gentle. And he's inviting us to be his disciples. He's inviting us to be his students. He's inviting us to follow his way. So it's not just a matter of kind of following a rule. Let's take the Sabbath, come back to that for a second. Jesus will say at one point, people were not made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for people. The Apostle Paul says something similar, I think, when he says that the letter of the law kills, but the spirit of the law gives life. And that spirit of the law is none other than the Holy Spirit, which we have been given, which lives in us and moves through us and animates us. And it's the same spirit that was in Jesus and animated Jesus. And this is what I think we're called for, or called to carry this message. So there are times, of course, to mourn. There's a time for the dirge to be played. There's a time to live. There's a time to fast, kind of like John the Baptist. But then there's also a time to feast. There's a time to celebrate. There's a time to come to the table and get over our differences and accept the forgiveness and grace and mercy that God is giving to us, and then become those types of people, people of grace and mercy and forgiveness in the world. And that is an easy yoke. That is a light burden. It's the one that Jesus offers us. And I pray that we can happily receive it and not resist it, as so many did in his day, and I think as so many have and continue to do in our day, but that we can receive it and we can carry it and we can offer it to others. I love you. And I hope this lesson today, I hope you can hear it, because I think it is great news. And I think believing it can really give you life. Amen.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing up Jesus Christ, the saving one. And we can see that God, you're moving a mighty river through the nations, and young and old will turn to Jesus and sing, fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen one. And open up the doors and let the music play, let the streams songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice. Did you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song? And all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness. Oh yes, we see, and we can see that God, you're moving. A time of jubilee is coming, a young and old return to Jesus to say, swing wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy. Dancers who dance upon injustice. Oh, dancers who dance upon injustice. Upon injustice.
Well, as we come to the table today, we want to remember our passage from the gospel that Jesus was sometimes called a drunkard and a glutton. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that Jesus actually was a glutton or a drunkard, as we said earlier, but it does mean that he had a reputation of being so. So it kind of begs the question about why would Jesus have such a reputation? And it's because he was often celebrating. He was often eating with people. And he was using the table, which in the Jewish tradition had been used in kind of an exclusive way. Think of the kosher rules, like what you could eat and what you couldn't eat, who you could eat with, who you couldn't eat with. But instead of using the table as a form of exclusion, Jesus took that table, such a meaningful event of gathering together and eating together, and he used it as a form of inclusion, kind of all the time seeking to have a meal with someone or with a group of people. And he really wasn't a respecter of persons. You know, he'd eat with Pharisees, he'd eat with tax collectors, he'd eat with zealots, he'd eat with prostitutes. I mean, he just kind of ate with everyone, and he was always, I believe, welcoming them to the table and welcoming them to celebrate the coming of the kingdom and his way of being in the world. And so this Sunday morning, we wanted to kind of get a group together a little differently and kind of celebrate. And so we've come together, a few of us have come together, so that it's not just kind of me celebrating kind of in front of my camera alone, but we've at least virtually gathered together to celebrate. So let's come to the table. This is the table of the Lord, not of the church, but of the Lord. And it is made ready for those who love him and for those who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little. Come, you who have been here often and you who have not been here long. Come, because it is the Lord who invites you, and he wants to meet you here at the table. We pray, Lord God Almighty, that you would pour out your Spirit on these gifts in our various places where we are, that these gifts may become the body and blood of Christ, and that you might make us, through them, Christ's body, alive in the world. Because there is one loaf, we are one body, and because we who are many are one body, for we partake of the one loaf. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us in the power of the Word and the Spirit. On the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's all take and eat together. Likewise, after the meal, he took the cup and he gave thanks to God, and he gave the cup to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ is dead, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Let's take and drink. Lord God, we pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us, all of us who have gathered around your table today, who have partaken of these gifts of the bread and the cup, as they represent for us the body and the blood of Christ. May we be, for the world, the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. blessing and honor and glory and power be to your name. Amen. And now I pray for you that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that the love of God, and that the communion, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit would be with you all. Amen.
Hey everyone, thanks again so much for joining us. Before we let you go, we have the announcements.
Boom! We are opening up the lobby right after this is over so that you guys can fellowship with each other and continue the conversation. Be sure to type in a message either on the comments in YouTube or on Facebook and just let us know that you're here.
And the prayer room is also open. The prayer room is a space in a Zoom meeting where you can pray with a member of the pastoral staff. There's a link to that in the video description if you need prayer.
Upstreet Kids Ministry is creating videos every Sunday for your preschoolers and your elementary kids. And then the elementary kids, we have videos that we watch on Zoom at 6 on Monday nights. And then we do a game on Thursday nights. Be sure to check that out.
Hey, every Tuesday night we have labs, our learning and belonging sessions, and I've really been enjoying the conversations we've been having lately. If you're interested about joining that conversation, all you have to do is click on the link that's in the video description, or you can go to oasischurch.org/labs. And we're about to start a new series about the theology of worship. So if you've ever been curious about why we do things at Oasis the way that we do them and kind of what is the thinking and the methodology behind our liturgy here at Oasis, then this would be a great opportunity for you to learn a little bit more about that. So be sure to join us, click on that link or visit that website, and we'll make sure that you can get in on the conversation.
Pastor Kaff is doing a great job with the youth. Every Wednesday night, they meet at 7 o'clock and do a Zoom hangout and a Bible lesson. And then every other Friday, they are doing a game night over Zoom. If you want to find out information, go check out their Facebook or their Instagram account at Oasis Youth Ministry.
Well, every weekday morning, we go live from our Facebook page and do a morning devotional. It's a great time to kind of get into the Word, to have a time of meditation and prayer. If you don't already like us on Facebook, be sure to do that, and be sure to turn on the notifications for our live videos. That way, you'll never miss it whenever we go live.
Guys, on a personal level, I just wanted to let you know that Gina, I, and the girls, we made it safe and to Georgia, and we are so thankful for all the people that reached out and have been praying for us through this transition. We love you guys, and we miss you. I am looking forward to getting to spend a little bit of time with you over through online, through the Oasis Church services. But for now, I just want to say thank you. I hope you guys have a great week. And from all of us here at Oasis, we love you, and we'll hopefully get to see you soon. All right. Bye.
Have a great week, y'all. God bless.